So let's talk about choice. Sometimes when we say a sentence, deciding between one word or another is just a matter of taste, without any real effect. And other times, the differences are game-changing. But some choices are sneaky, with options that look similar enough but lead you to strange and unexpected endings. How can we avoid confusion and make sure that we've chosen the right path? I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
So imagine you said, Stanley seems to be alone. But then you think a bit more and realize, no, on second thought, Stanley wants to be alone. Swapping out one word for another seems pretty easy, right? We just pluck out seems and plug in once, game over. It's like applying a new coat of paint. The sentence looks a little different, but the underlying structure is intact. But when we consider what we've learned about syntax so far, something doesn't sit quite right. If you look back to our video about theta rules, you'll remember that each verb is a bit like a screenplay that's been written with certain sets of rules in mind. In order for the movie to make sense, these rules need to be filled with the right number and right kinds of noun phrases so that the verb fits comfortably into the sentence. To make sure that the verb always gets what it needs, we introduced the theta criterion, which is like the casting director, and makes sure that each part is cast with exactly one actor, no more and no less. But just what roles are being assigned in those sentences? In both cases, Stanley's definitely the one who's alone, and in the second sentence, Stanley's definitely doing the wanting. But in the first sentence, is Stanley really actively doing any seeming? I mean, what would it even mean for someone to seem? It doesn't look like these verbs are assigning the same roles. But that means we have to figure out exactly what role a verb like seem assigns to Stanley, and the answer to that problem doesn't seem so obvious. To make matters even worse, it turns out the two verbs aren't as interchangeable as they first appear to be. So we can say something like, it seems Stanley is alone, but we definitely can't say it wants Stanley is alone. So what's going on here? To solve this mystery, we'll start by zooming in on what exactly that it is doing before seem. Not only is it not doing any seeming, it doesn't seem to refer to anything. It's just this weird, empty, dummy pronoun sitting at the front of the sentence like a soulless worker stuck in some meaningless job. But we've seen these sorts of pronouns in other places too. We find them at the beginnings of sentences about the weather, like it's cold, or in so-called there sentences, like there's nobody in the office. If you think back to when we talked about the principles and parameters of universal grammar, you might remember that these dummy pronouns tend to show up in some languages and not others. Syntacticians have dubbed this switch the null subject parameter. Null subject languages like Italian or Polish happily leave these empty words out, while non-null subject languages like English or French have no choice but to include them. So while you have to say it rains in English, you can drop the subject completely and say piove in Italian. The it is meaningless, it doesn't even get a theta role, its only purpose is to be a subject. Okay, so that's what that it is doing there before seem. It's like a seat filler. So how come sometimes we find Stanley there instead? Well, think about it this way. Verbs like seem don't assign theta roles to their subjects any more than verbs like rain do. Seem doesn't need an agent, and it couldn't even really have one if it wanted to, it just wouldn't make any sense. Like, what would something even be seeming? But because English needs a noun phrase there anyway, it can employ the pronoun it, or it can decide to steal a noun phrase from below. It can steal Stanley. So in a sentence like Stanley seems to be alone, even though Stanley really belongs much closer to alone than to seem, the higher verb gets jealous and snatches Stanley up, putting him all the way at the front of the sentence. Since it's next to alone in the underlying form, it gets its theta rule there and then moves up to the top. For this reason, verbs like seem are known as raising verbs, because their subjects start off low and then get raised up. By stacking one raising verb on top of another, we can even watch as Stanley climbs the tree. It seems it is likely Stanley is alone can become it seems Stanley is likely to be alone, which can turn into Stanley seems likely to be alone. Neat! But we've only told you half the parable so far. What about the verb want, or even choose, or try? It doesn't look like they're raising verbs, because they don't need to steal their subjects from anybody. In Stanley chose to walk through the door on the right, Stanley's definitely doing the choosing. Problem is, he's doing the walking, too. And this looks like a violation of the theta criterion, because we're not allowed to get one noun phrase playing two parts. But maybe that's okay, though. Maybe Stanley starts off with one theta role and then climbs up the tree to get another one. Maybe Stanley's just strapped for cash and needs to take on two jobs. Maybe it's just the exception that proves the rule. Except we can show that that can't be true because of the behavior of idioms. Idioms are chunks of words whose overall meanings don't seem to follow from the meanings of their individual parts. So, like, the narrator let the cat out of the bag doesn't really mean there were any captive kitties. It just means that he divulged some secret. And if Mariella was beside herself, it doesn't mean that she has a twin or a clone or anything. It just means that she was taken aback. But in order for idioms to keep their idiomatic meaning, they need to stay chunky. That means they need to enter a sentence fully formed and ready to go. They can't wait to be built up piece by piece. But what does this have to do with our verbal confusion? Well, say I'm talking about Chris, and I tell you that the apple seems to have fallen far from the tree. You'd know that I mean that he grew up to be different from his parents. But if I tell you that the apple decided to fall far from the tree, it sounds like I'm talking about some surprisingly smart and inexplicably ambulatory piece of fruit. That's because in the raising sentence, the idiom started off all packaged together way down below at the bottom with its idiomatic meaning intact, and then seem picked the apple out of the tree and put it front and center, because all English sentences need subjects. In the other sentence, the apple started off at the beginning as the subject of decide. It was never anywhere near the tree to begin with, and so the idiom never even got off the ground. So if Stanley's the one in control of his decisions in a sentence like Stanley decided to press the button for 4 hours, and Stanley's also the one doing all the button pressing, how do we make sure that Stanley gets a theta rule from both verbs without moving him around or breaking our existing rules? To get through the problem, we'll have to introduce something new to our syntactic theory, silent pronouns. We've already seen some silent constituents in our trees before, like the traces left behind after moving a word from one part of a sentence to another. Silent pronouns, which we'll call pro, are a bit like traces. You can't hear them, but they have tangible effects on the sentences they show up in. So basically, for a sentence like Stanley was reluctant to follow the adventure line, its tree would end up looking like this. That pro in the lower clause is like a silent reflexive pronoun. It refers back to Stanley in much the same way that a word like himself does. And because certain verbs impose this kind of structure onto the sentence, where the subject controls the meaning of this silent pronoun, we call them control verbs. Now, it's pretty convenient for us to suppose that there's this thing we can't even see that lets us keep the idea that each noun phrase gets exactly one theta rule by giving Stanley one and pro the other. But do we have any actual independent evidence that this silent pronoun exists? Well, for one, we do see full noun phrases in the same spot, like in the narrator didn't expect Stanley to spend so much time in the broom closet. If we drop Stanley and replace him with pro, we then get the narrator didn't expect to spend so much time in the broom closet, where we understand that the narrator didn't expect it of himself. Pro is filling in for the narrator. And we also have some pretty strong evidence from binding theory. We know that the first principle of binding theory, principle A, says that reflexive pronouns have to refer back to something inside their own clause. Since we can easily say something like Stanley refused to help himself, it looks like there must be something inside the lower embedded clause that we can't see, which binds himself because Stanley is too far away in the higher clause to do it. If pro weren't in there, the sentence would collapse under the weight of principle A and the whole story would end in disaster. Raising and control verbs look very similar on the surface, but deep down they generate very different structures with pretty big changes in meaning too. Picking one word or another might seem trivial, but as it turns out, small choices can have a big impact. So we've reached the end of the Ling space for this week. If you controlled your interpretations right, you learned that swapping out one verb for another can drastically alter the underlying structure of a sentence. That raising verbs need subjects just like other verbs do, and will sometimes resort to stealing them from other parts of the sentence. And that control verbs look an awful lot like raising verbs, but don't involve movement, and instead use a silent pronoun called pro. The Ling space is produced by me, Moti Lieberman, and directed by Dailise Prévost. This week's episode was written by Stéphane Hurtubise. Our editor is George Coulomb, our music is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Muse. We're down in the comments below, or you can bring the discussion back over to our website where we'll have some extra material on this topic. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook, and drop by our new store. And if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Ka emesya.